Happy Sabbath, church.
God is just a prayer away, and all you need to do is call. He will hear your faintest cry. He's concerned about you. Trust in his holy words, and he will see you through. He is here. He will lift your heavy hearts. He's in love with you. He knows. He cares. He sees. He's there. He will carry. He will carry you. He's concerned about you. Weeping may endure for a night, but the morning will bring joy. He won't give you more than you can bear. He's concerned about you. He loves you. Oh yes. He loves you. Oh, Jesus loves you. Oh, yes, he does. Yes, he does. He's concerned about you. He knows. He cares. He sees. He's there. He will carry. He will carry you, oh yeah. He's concerned. He knows, he cares, he sees, he's there, and he will carry you, oh yes, he will. He's concerned about you. He's concerned about you. He's concerned
Sister Doris, Sister Doris. I was coming to church and see her sitting on that back row. Gil said to me, "You're in for a treat." Sister Doris, Sister Doris. Hallelujah. Thank you, sis. So appropriate. Thank you so much. Let's pray. Father God, we're here to hear from you. Hide me behind the cross. Prepare our hearts to receive what you have to say. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Last Sabbath, snowing. The ushers, if you would, pass out the copies. We're going to catch ourselves up from last Sabbath, when we was interrupted, but God is still good. And what they're passing out, we begin, this is a two-part series. Last Sabbath, we fall down. What causes failure in our lives? And that's one. And I'll catch you up on last Sabbath. And then this Sabbath, we're going to do part two, how to overcome the fear of failure. The fear, Overcoming the fear of failure. So that first sheet you'll look at, it will say, we fall down, Proverbs 24:16. We fall down, and we're going to catch ourselves up in where we left off last week. It's a two-part series, and y'all, what's happening to me, and I've said this to a couple of people, I am, after being in the church since 1980, I'm beginning to eat solid food now. It's been milk all along. I told that to my students at work, and they said, Mr. Dawkins, you eat meat now? No, I'm not eating meat. I'm just eating off the word. And I had a Bible study. I had three Bible studies a week, and I had a Bible study a Thursday night, and it was something that was energizing me in our study. It was a question, how can you be sure that the faith and love in your relationship with Christ will continue to increase? And it says, search the scriptures, pray without ceasing, and as you therefore have received Jesus Christ, the Lord, so walk in him. And then it also says, I die daily. So you have to begin that by understanding every day you wake up, you're going to have to search the scriptures. You're going to pray without ceasing. And once you receive Jesus Christ, you're going to walk in him. But you're also going to have to die to the things, those sins that you have acquired along the way. All right. As you got sheep one, on one side will be one and the second side will be two. So we're going to deal with we fall down. Last week, I emphasized through the aid of the Holy Spirit, we underestimate our what? Strength. We underestimate our strength. We underestimate standing firm for God. Once we have received this from God, we underestimate our strength. And we talked about Peter. Peter had a problem. Oh, God, I'll go with you all the way. I don't care what happened, you know, and we get into that mode. So number two was we fear the what? Blank of others. Disapproval of others. We're always looking for that. We're always seeking that. Number three, we speak without what? Thinking. We speak without thinking. Number four, we should grieve the failure so that we can start all over and start right. So we should grieve the failure. Number five, let your small groups or your prayer partners support you. You're going to need somebody else to help you through whatever you're going through. If it's a small group or if it's your, I encourage you to get a prayer partner. So that y'all can pray together, you know, and you need that support. Number six, cast what? Cast myself on God's what? Mercy. Y'all, mercy, they're twins. Grace and mercy, they go together. They're free. They are free. So they go together, all right? So mercy is that case. So we begin today with how to overcome the fear of failure. Now, we learned last Sabbath that God isn't shocked of what we're going through right now. He's there to help us out. Psalms 103:14. God prays for us. He's interceding for us right now in heaven. He's interceding for us. We also learned that God believes in us. He believes in us because he knows we're just dust. We're just dust. Now, Elder Davis read, we all know this scripture. And by the way, if you're at the nursing home today, I'm going to get right into this particular scripture again. But we need to understand that. I remember in grade school, that's when they had prayer in school. That's when they had Ten Commandments up on the wall. Then, you know, we all learned this. I think I learned it probably third or fourth grade. Psalms 23. This is a psalm of the time of weariness. Because we have to understand a shepherd. And what does a shepherd do? So it says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. I shall not lack of anything. All right? But it says, he maketh me to lie down in green pastures, and he leadeth me beside the still waters. So we see the shepherd and his rod that he has with him is so important to that sheep. Because the sheep is steady watching that shepherd. He restoreth my soul, and he leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake, for Jesus' name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod, thy staff, they comfort me. Now, this is the sheep now. The sheep knows this. That's why they're steady watching the shepherd. We have to understand we have this relationship with God, y'all. He's going to take care of us. He knows that we're just dust. He knows that we need him. So every day you get up, you're going to have some type, you should have some type of relationship with him. Now, I'll say this. The only way you're going to do that, you're going to have to read his word. You're going to have a cup. I was telling my Bible students on Thursday night, I was enjoying 3 Bible studies a week. Y'all, I'm enjoying. I'm there for them. I'm supposed to be there for them, but they're there for me because of what we're studying. And it's just shoring things within my brain. I'm excited. I'm excited about the Bible study because it's helping me. Because you're ever learning. You're ever learning. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointeth my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So we see here that he maketh me, he leadeth me, he restoreth me, he leadeth me, and he prepareth, he anointeth. We have to understand those things, that God is there for us at all times. So let's understand something here, that how we overcome the fear of failure. I mean, we have failure in our lives. There are things going on in our lives every day. Romans, the 8th chapter, verse 31 through 39, and this is in the English Standard Version of the Bible. It says, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies us. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, and more than that, who has raised and who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Should tribulations? Should disaster? Through persecution? Through famine? Through nakedness? Or danger or sword? And I understand that because we have a contagious disease that's covering the world right now. It has us all in panic. But if you have established your relationship with God, our fear is dying. Now, our fear is dying. But if you have established a relationship with God, you shouldn't worry about anything. You should not worry about anything. You should cast all of your cares on him because he created you. Then there is the psalm that we just read, and I won't go back over that. I just encourage you to go back and read Psalms 23, 1 through 6 over and over again. But then there's Luke, the 12th chapter, Luke, the 12th chapter, verse 6 and 7. And this, the visuals on this is so positive for me. Are not five sparrows sold for 2 pennies? And not one of them is forgotten before God. Why, even the hairs on my head are numbered. Fear not, you are of more value than many of the sparrows. Did you get it? Y'all, it's amazing how the animal kingdom reacts to God. He takes care of them. But more importantly, God loves us so much, he can take care of you and I. We have to allow ourselves to understand he loves us so much. I have to reassure myself every day. Sister Noelle, I have to reassure myself every day. He loves me so much. I have to pray without ceasing. And then there's 1 John 4, 18 and 19. 1 John 4, 18 and 19. There is no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. We love because he first loved us. Now, let me get into, and this is going to be quick, and you know, it's amazing what people say to me. Say to you on the way out of the church. And last week I got some great comments. It's amazing. People really speak up and they really say those things. And I went home thinking about all the comments that I got at the door. But I'm going to make this very plain because it doesn't take a long time to really understand how much God loves us. I want you to understand that, remember that everyone fails. All of us in here fails. James, the 3rd chapter, verse 2, says that we all stumble in many ways. Knowing that, we're here at this hospital. We come in to really encourage and support each other through the struggles that we're going through. But it's to Christ that can help us through those struggles. Then in Ecclesiastes, the 7th chapter, verse 20, there is no one earth who does what is right all the time and never makes a mistake. There's nobody. So you can get off the high horse and understand I'm in the same situation that you are. But I say, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. George Washington Carver said, you're going to love this, Elder Bartley. George Washington Carver says that 98% of those who fail always make excuses for their failures and then blame it on somebody else. I don't want nobody to know that I failed. I have a situation where when I fail, I've learned that I fail, I go back, look at the situation. So what have I learned? Because, y'all, I don't want to make the same mistake again. What have I learned from what I just came out of? It's important to analyze every situation. God's going to test us to the day we die. I think about this all the time. Okay, so Lucifer sinned in heaven. He was thrown out of heaven. God could have just wiped him off the face of the universe right then and there. So he allows him to land to this earth, and this earth, we're the only planet within the universe that are going through what we're going through, because everybody else is watching us. So God says, I'm going to give you 6,000 years to do what you got to do. But y'all, he will not let sin back into heaven again. That's what this journey is about. And the big part of this journey, y'all, when we're able to get there, even the angels in heaven will ask you, so I watched you go through whatever you were going through. Tell me, how did you get over? And you can say, oh, by the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. By the blood of the Lamb. Nobody, no human beings in the entire universe would have gone through what we've gone through. We have a story to tell. And that story is Jesus Christ. I do want to say to you that failure, I want you to realize something. Failure is not fatal. It's not going to end your life. Proverbs, the 24th chapter, verse 16 says, no matter how often an honest man, a righteous man falls, ain't going to get up seven times, you can always get up and start all over again. God has provided for you. All you have to do is depend on him. You know, I shared with you last week all the things that I failed. Business, marriage, all of those things. The list goes on and on. But the good part about it, God allowed me to get back up and start all over again. Praise ye the Lord. He's always there. I was working with a young lady at work, and she's from Indiana. I don't know if I said this last week. From Indiana, God told her, you need to get to Greenville, South Carolina. He told her what to do. He told her about the job and all of that. So she's got the job. She's one of my coworkers, whatever. And Gil, you can understand this because I like the way you taught this Sabbath school lesson this morning in regards to the people in your fear in your job and all those people around you. So her boss, her supervisor, is giving her hell now. She's only been in the job 3 months. Her supervisor is giving her hell. So I said to her, this is the reason God brought you from Indiana and brought you to Greenville Technical College. It's for your supervisor. It's for your supervisor. And she can't understand that. She's panicking, you know. She got down here and got this house has to pay a rent for $2,000, and she needs to get out of that about the 18th. And she kept coming. I said, hey, it's just as plain as anything. You keep praying to the Lord. And I said, listen to him. He's going to give you an answer. But the interesting thing about her, now, the 18th is what, Tuesday? So she needs to be out of this place. First of all, $2,000 is too much. You know, but hey, I didn't want to tell her that, whatever. But God, and we were praying. I've been praying for her. She comes to my office every morning, been praying for her and telling her, listen, God has an answer for you. God has an answer. And she's waiting on God to come to her and give her an answer. But guess what? God got to somebody else, that somebody else said something to her the other day. See, and I shared with her. See, Moses, the water, the Red Sea wouldn't have parted unless all God told Moses to do, take the rod, struck the water, take the step. That's all you got to do. Hey, the water parted. I'm saying to you, y'all, when God says something, that's all you got to do. He's got your back. Now, so she comes to my office Friday morning. Oh, I was talking to my friend. I found this place. It's $800 less than what I'm paying. And hey, that's all you had to do. Listen to God. He's revealing stuff to you through other people. But the key here is her supervisor. Her supervisor is all over the place. What she has to do now is her supervisor needs something that she has. And she has to pray her way to find out what that is. So that's her assignment. Y'all, we all have assignments. I'm getting you ready for August. Y'all, I don't think you really know what's about to happen in Greenville, South Carolina, but it's going to take all of us to get this community together. So you always making excuses. I don't know how to give a Bible study. I don't know how to talk to this person. So the Southern Union said, oh, we're going to send some people in here to help you through that. Y'all, all it is getting on your knees. You can say, I don't know that much about the Bible. Folks are going to ask me a question. I don't know what to say. My Bible students will tell you, when we get into the Bible study, I'll say to them, I don't know everything. I just know a little bit. I say, if you ask me a question, I'll get back to you. And it's just as simple as that. Or I can rely on the Holy Spirit of what I've studied already to help me through the process. It's just that simple. So what she has to do with her supervisor, she has to find the need of her supervisor and help her supervisor with that. So getting back to the understanding of realizing it is not fatal, Paul makes it very plain in 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, verse 8 and 9. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. See, failure, is refusing to try. Did you get it? Failure is refusing to try. You're giving up. You're giving up. You're not trying. You're not even asking God either. You're not asking. Y'all, I'm going to tell you this. The Holy Spirit knows everything. He's with you at all times. You can call on him at any time. Tuesday, I was in Columbia. I was with some students or whatever, and I had given them detail on what we were going to do the whole day. Detail. My wife will tell you, when I say detail, you can only go to the bathroom on that agenda. That's how detailed I am. Gave them instructions. So we get through half the day. I took them to the state house. They had to do some things. They did Richland County District 2, the whole thing. So about 2 o'clock, I had to pick up one group over to Richland County District 2. And I get there, and the young man that I had with me at the state house, he says, Mr. Dawkins, I lost my car keys. I said, oh, my God. He said, I think I left them at the hotel. Now, we checked out of the hotel 7:30 that morning. I didn't fret. The Holy Spirit knows everything. In my spirit, I started praying. He said, well, we can go after the reception this evening. No, we'll come back up that road. I said, we're going to the hotel right now. So as I was driving, I'm praying. We get to the hotel, and the Holy Spirit says, get out of the car with him because he don't know what to say. I get out of the car with him, go in, and he did. He asked the lady or whatever, and for about 5 minutes, they looked. They found the keys. Then the other student gets out of the car and says, Mr. Dawkins, I think I left my umbrella. Jesus. Jesus. Now, y'all know me by now. I do quickie prayers. I did a quickie. Well, they did. They went upstairs. They found the umbrella. So, okay. So my key here is then to say to them, God, the Holy Spirit knows everything. God is aware of what you're going through. I had to say that to them because it wasn't me. It's that God's in control of all things. And that's why I want to say to you, y'all, you sit here, you go through the things. Yeah, we elders, we get from you, pray for me this and pray for me that. You can also pray for yourself too as well. I'm going through something. My family's going through something. It's just amazing, but you have to always pray. My wife got up the other morning saying that she needed to go see Sister Griffin, and she did. So by the time I got home, she says, I went to see Sister Griffin. And actually, Sister Griffin knew her. When she walked, Free said, Sister Griffin, do you know who I am? She said, yeah, Sister Dawkins. And I said to the elder this morning, if you can, get by to see y'all because she needs that in her atmosphere right now. Can you imagine getting up every day not knowing the people in the nursing home? She needs that right now. That will help her spirit to know that somebody is thinking about her. What I want you to know, number three, what I want you to know is recognize the benefits of not failing, or the benefits that God gives you, okay? Here's the understanding. Recognize the benefits. I'm going to say this to you. God uses failure to test you. God uses failures. I'm going to give you three. He uses failure to educate us. Proverbs, the 28th chapter, verse 13. A man who refuses to admit his mistakes can never be successful. God uses failure to educate us. Y'all, he has, in God's providence, he's going to test everybody in here. See, you can say all day and night, oh, I want to go to heaven. Oh, yes, I want to go. Hallelujah, I want to go to heaven. When that first test comes, you panic. You can't take it. You're not ready. He's going to test everybody. You just can't say, I'm going to heaven. You just can't say that. So he's not going to allow sin into heaven again. So you're going to have to go through a test. Now, you got to understand what I said from the beginning. God is with you all the way through the test, while the test is going on, after the test is over with. You then have to look back on it and say, what did I learn from that situation? So you will not repeat or have to go back through that test again. Hallelujah. You got quiet on me. That's plain. God uses failure to motivate us. Some of you have been sitting in that same seat and will not leave that seat ever again. Some of you, when we go out, pass out tracts, when we ask you to give a Bible, I can't do it. I don't know what to do. My feet hurt. I bet you that job Monday morning, you get up out of there and go to work. It's just as plain. It's... Y'all, have to be busy about our Father's business. So here's to motivate us. Proverbs, the 20th chapter, verse 30. Sometimes it takes a painful situation to make us change our ways. Oh, I lost my job. Yeah, okay. Oh, my child died. Y'all, I had to say this. I was in Columbia when the little girl, they couldn't find the little girl. And, y'all, I was just praying. I can just only imagine what a parent is going through at that moment. But a lot of things went through my head. If my child is 5 years old, 3 years old, 2 years, 6 years old, and she get off the bus every day at the same time, guess what? I'm going to be right there. I'm going to be right there. You got to understand, these children of ours have not fully developed. They don't know. So she gets off the bus, and she's just playing in the yard. She don't know to go in the house and tell my mom here or whatever. She's playing in the yard. And watch it come out. Because you know it's the other body was the neighbor around the corner. You just need to pray for the family. Y'all, we take for granted. My wife says we should not assume in these cases with these children now today. Even if they're 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 years old. I had to talk to a young man on Friday. Don't assume they know it. They don't know it. Another example of that, you know my itinerary for these young men. I put them, we went to Embassy Suites. They had a suite. It was the three of them. I had my suite. Okay? They went and checked in. So I'm assuming they know what to do. So it was two twin beds, pull out sofa. Next morning, we're checking out, getting ready, get in a vehicle, and some said, let me ask them, how did you sleep last night? I said, well, what's that? I said, well, who had the sofa? Oh, Mr. I had the sofa, Mr. Dawkins. I said, well, how well do you sleep? I said, what's that? I said, he said, well, I didn't have cover and I didn't have a pillow. I said, hold it. In the hotel, the extra cover and the pillow is always in the closet at the top. So, okay, y'all didn't put your clothes in the closet? He slept all night without any cover. My wife says to me, don't never assume that they know. I know what to do next time. Is to, once we check in, I need to take him to the room and he pulled out the sofa. He pulled out the sofa. The fact he didn't have any cover. That's the thing. What I'm saying to you, as I stop with that thing, never assume. So we need to be motivated. We don't need to be motivated when one of our children or our grandchildren go to jail. And you, oh, Lord, help me. Oh, Lord, help me. Well, okay. All right, number three. God uses failure to cultivate me, meaning to prepare me, to grow me, to develop me. Romans, the 5th chapter, verse 3 and 4. We can rejoice when we run into problems, trials, for we know that they are good for us. They develop our strength of character. So he has to cultivate us. All right. What I want to say to you in these last points, and then we'll end, is that we really need to relax in God's grace. All grace is, they're God's riches at Christ's expense. Meaning he died for us so that we can have grace. Now, don't misuse grace. People feel that, oh, I got grace. I can do just about anything. No, you cannot do anything. So, grace is free because Christ paid the ultimate price. Salvation is free because Christ paid the price. So, guess what? Everybody in here like free, right? The key here is taking advantage of something that's free to us, and that's God's grace and God's salvation for us. So, Psalms 103, verse 14, God knows what we are made of. He remembers that we're just dust. So, with that in mind, he's always there for us. Colossians, the second chapter, verse 14, God canceled our debt, which listed all the rules we failed to follow. He took away that record from its rules and nailed it to the cross. So when we look at grace, the G is for God, the R is for riches, the A is at Christ's, and the E is for expense. So the G is for God, the R is for riches, the A is for at, the C is for Christ, the E is for expense. God's riches at Christ's expense. So 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, verse 8, love never fails. Love never fails. But then he makes it very plain in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verse 15. Be careful that no one fails to receive God's grace. God's grace is so important to us. God understands where we are, what we're involved in, and what we're doing. So if you can remember the things that's necessary for us to remember, you can survive in this world. So right now, I just wouldn't be fooling you to understand that everyone in here is going through something right now. He allowed all of us to come to this hospital. We came from all different backgrounds. And I don't know if you wonder why you're here. Why did he get you here? And look at your own family, because in some cases, you're the only person within your family that's here. It's like being a loner in a way, because you take the pressures of your family, but there's a drive in you that keeps you coming. And you have to understand that. So how do I fit in all of this? It's not by accident that he got you to this point. Y'all, you should not let it get away from you. You should not give up because he got you this far. And don't just, the world is doing their thing. Just don't give up because he got you this far. Then you have to figure out, okay, God, so where are you trying to take me? What do I have to learn out of this situation? And that's what it's all about, y'all. That's what this journey is all about. And I'm telling you from the heart. Oh, yeah, I used to smoke marijuana. Oh, I used to eat just about anything. Oh, I used to be out there drinking. But God, I often say, right when I was taking that joint to smoke it, he was right there. He knew that in the long run, I needed him more than anything. And y'all, and I'm thankful. Y'all, hallelujah. I'm thankful. I'm really thankful. So that's what we have to realize in this journey that we're on. I love all of you just like I love my family, because we are a family within this sphere here. So let's bow our heads, and there may be someone here today that wants to take that first step. It's something about Bible study, I think, that is so important. So you want to take that first step. Just bow your heads right now. Father God, once again, you have showed up. And you know, Father God, I'm excited because I cannot wait to hear Doris's second song. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's not by accident that Ruby has brought her into the setting, and she's agreed to sing in this setting. Hallelujah. I want to be blessed, Lord. And then there's somebody that night would like to start a new beginning. I hear you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is saying that our visitors to today, somebody within our visitors' rim is going through something. I want to pray for all of our visitors today. God is just with you. Whatever you're going through right now, God's with you. God's with you. And I want to pray for those that are in pain right now. Those that are in a situation that they can't see their way out. God wants to say to you, he got you. He's got you. Father God, thank you for this opportunity. Is there one today that like to start a new beginning in Christ Jesus? The doors of the church are open. Lord, I thank you for this moment. You're a good God, and Lord, you love me so much. I ask in Jesus' name, I pray, amen and amen.
In letters of crimson, God wrote his love on a hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, he bled and died, and love's greatest story was told. I love you, I love you. That's what Calvary said. I love you, I love you, I love you, written in red. And down through the ages, God wrote his love with the same hands that suffered and bled, giving all he had to give, a message so easily read. I love you, I love you. That's what Calvary said. I love you. I love you. I love you written in red. How precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. There is no other fountain that I know. No, no, nothing but the blood. The blood of Jesus. I love you. Oh, I really do. That's what Calvary, that's what Calvary said. I love you, I love you, I love you. That is why he died for you. Yes, he did. I love you written in red, in red. It's written in red.
You know, my mom used to say it's them quiet ones you have to watch. Since the door is in our Wednesday prayer service, don't say much. You're going to start singing now, you know. Let the church stand up for our benediction. Weren't we blessed today? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for coming down and joining us today in this place. You joined us in the sermon. You joined us in the music. And now we ask, Father God, that you'll stay with us as we travel to our various homes. Give us traveling mercies. Be with us as we go to our next appointed meetings, Father God, and be with us there. And let us arrive safely.